Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. It's been nearly 3 weeks ago that I made the decision to move the state of Indiana. They're with us. Are you talking to them? Everything good? Okay. Pardon that technical interruption. Thanks for joining us this afternoon. It was nearly 3 weeks ago that I made the decision to move Indiana to stage five and lift some of the restrictions that had been previously put in place. By all accounts, the state was trending in the right direction. In mid-September, you'll recall our seven-day positivity dipped under 4%, and our hospitalizations and census counts were also decreasing. Our state positivity map was largely showing counties in the blue, exactly where we want them to be and remain, with low and manageable community spread. I said then, if you recall, that we would have to be ever vigilant, even going to stage five. It was a reminder that we had to be ever vigilant about taking the precautions that helped us move to stage five, all that progress, that we needed to be mindful and look to take care of our Hoosier neighbors, whether we knew them or not, by wearing face coverings, by socially distancing, by being careful at events, whether they were small, medium, or large, whether they were inside or even outside our most familiar surroundings like our households, especially as we were moving and are moving flu season right now. And temperatures, beautiful day today, we want to make sure that as temperatures get colder and cooler and people start to go indoors more permanently, that we're being very mindful of our surroundings. And so, in short, practicing all those basics, the well-known, proven best practices that work to reduce the odds of contracting or transmitting this very lethal virus. Stage five is not the stage where the checkered flag comes out. Stage five is not an excuse for indifference or irresponsibility, just the opposite. And yet, while there are so many Hoosiers who are practicing these best practices, we just all know, we see with our own eyes, that's not the case for everyone. And I know we're not alone. This is happening all over the world. People are tired of this. People have mask fatigue. People are wanting, yearning, as a matter of fact, to get back to the old days, the good old days, how we used to socialize, get together very closely. You're even probably tired or pained, not an overstatement, as am I, of hearing about the numbers of positive cases and hospitalizations and deaths, and even beyond the physical costs, also the financial costs that are as a result of all of this. But with every day comes reports, I remind you, of a lot of folks not wearing face covering. Even some of our health professionals, and at, again, large events where there's just zero regard for social distancing, even knowing that it's increasing the odds of community spread. In less than a month, our positivity rate has moved from under 4% to where it sits today, 5.3%. We've had a record high number of positive cases reported, and more concerning, the number of hospitalizations is increasing to a level we have not seen since the spring. The good news is, day in and day out, again, I just want to stress this, I do see Hoosiers who are making wise decisions that show that they care and have high regard for others around them. They're wearing masks, they're social distancing, they're reducing the odds by putting others not into peril. They're actually helping us slow the spread and get through this. It turns out it's children at our schools who are showing us how it's done, and the administrators, to be sure, how this can be done safely. But we also, as I allude to, all see Hoosiers who are, again, showing just a disregard for the health of their fellow citizens. And that can mean, ultimately, those actions and inactions can mean whether or not our kids are able to stay in school, in class, receiving that instruction in class, in the classroom. It can also affect the most vulnerable among us, or can affect the rate of those going hungry or homeless, as if this current situation and this coronavirus doesn't exist. Those decisions can directly or indirectly, even not intentionally, again, cost lives. More than 3,609, to be exact, as of today. And those decisions, or lack thereof, good decisions, are affecting our quality of life, both short-term and long-term. There's so much about this virus we don't know on every age group. So we want to make sure that, you know, as we are going through each and every day, that we're underscoring the fact that it is, again, our actions or our inactions. And those inactions are costing, just to be blunt, healthcare costs, lost wages, business failures. Don't kid yourself, we're all paying this bill. The bill's coming due. And throwing caution to the wind ultimately ends up costing us all. It is the literal definition of whistling past the graveyard, pretending this isn't around us. And we're not the transmitters of it. Dr. Box and her team remain very concerned that close contact events such as weddings and funerals and the receptions and family events like house parties that come after those events, where people, it's just easier to let your guard down and be more trusting and just assume that the odds aren't there working against you. And then forget about the face mask and the social distancing. Those events are the very events that turn out to be big contributors to our positive cases and illnesses. It's these events that have nothing to do with a 500 capacity limit. Tracing is proving that. We are proving that you can go to a Colts game or a soccer game or school or go shopping, and you can do it safely. The numbers, in fact, have everything to do with how many of us are and aren't letting our guard down, even at smaller events and medium-sized and bigger events, where safety protocols are not put into place or practice or reinforced. Other states, you look around us, other states who have capacity limits of 10 people at some events or venues are still facing surging numbers. This has everything to do, again, I'll say it for the fifth time, has everything to do with our actions and our inactions. It's because too many are ignoring science and are rolling the dice as if, again, somebody's going to pay that bill for us. We can only control what we can control. And in my mind, wearing a mask is a layup. One lady recently wrote me and said that when she sees folks wearing a mask, it reminds her of Hoosier hospitality and kind of our calling card, our caring for others. And there are so many events. Again, they can take place anywhere. That's why we have to be ever vigilant. And Dr. Box is on the line with us today. She is remotely connected, and she will provide us with a personal update and further underscore just where and how this can occur. And with that, I will turn it over to you, Doc.
Thanks, Governor. Good afternoon, Hoosiers. I'm really sorry that I can't be with you there today in person, but unfortunately, I need to let you know that my daughter, Catherine, my grandson, Liam, and I have all tested positive for COVID-19. You know, really, from the beginning of this pandemic, my husband, David, and I have included in our kind of social bubble, family bubble, our four grown children and their spouses, three of which live here in town, and our 23-month-old grandson, Liam. And we have consistently, since March, been with them, usually once on a weekend, normally for having a family dinner, sometimes, oftentimes, sitting out back or enjoying the fire pit, just enjoying family time. But otherwise, our exposure is very, very limited, and we're very, very careful, my husband and I, about wearing our masks and social distancing and making sure that we are in public, we're protecting ourselves, because both of us, that date on our birth certificate puts us a little bit at risk. But we've always known that our little grandson, Liam, who we sometimes refer to as our bioterrorist, bring home. He'd go to an outside daycare, which is a home daycare, very small number of kids and caretakers. Unfortunately, David, I said for Liam on Friday, and he subsequently ended up with a cold, which his mom ended up with over the weekend. And then unfortunately, two of their daycare workers turned up positive for COVID-19. As soon as I found that out on Tuesday afternoon, I gathered my things at work and went home, and my daughter and her wife and my grandson, Liam, we all went to get tested. Our original PCR test was a quick test, a point-of-care test, all came back negative, so we were somewhat reassured by that. My daughter had developed symptoms by this time also, and then, unfortunately, our lab test came back positive for both Catherine and I and for Liam. Catherine and Liam are mild and symptomatic. Fortunately, they seem to be doing well. I'm not symptomatic in any way, shape, or form, which makes it that much more difficult. I've already talked with our state epidemiologist and participated in contact tracing. Personally, have called a couple of people. I was at my dental office, but there and everyone else that I've talked to, really, we have carefully socially distanced, and they officially wore their PPE while they were doing dental work. And so we're really going to have limited to no individuals who are close contacts, except for my immediate family, that will need to quarantine and or isolate depending on whether they become ill. And that's really because we do practice social distancing. We do wear our masks, and now we're appropriately tested and contact tracing. I'm really not looking forward to being at home and working from home and planning for the next 10 days, either symptomatic or asymptomatic at this point. We'll wait and see how that works out. God willing, none of us will become more ill than mildly symptomatic, and we'll be back in society kind of experiencing that new norm, but still wearing our masks and socially distancing and making sure that we're being careful. I just really want to ask to make sure that you listen to the governor and saying that you listen to Dr. Weaver and what they're saying, because our numbers are not good and they're very concerning. And it's especially concerning to me to see what's happening in our hospitals in several areas around the state. So please be careful. Please, please be responsible. And if there are people around you not being responsible, especially if they're people that you love and you're close to, point out that to them the importance. I will keep everybody up to date on how I'm doing, but I certainly will continue to be engaged as long as I'm feeling up to it. And I just want to wish all of you the best of luck and pray that all of you will start to be continued if you already are responsible about social distancing and wearing your mask. Thank you.
Well, we are all wishing you a speedy recovery, Dr. Box, and to your daughter and your grandson. And just know, as you are for me, Doc, I am on call 24/7 for you. So just we'll be talking soon, but you're in our prayers. Now, again, before I turn it over to Dr. Weaver, we're at the end of the first 3 weeks of stage 5, and I've made the decision to continue it for the next month, at least for now. We will revisit our status in a week. I'll be right back here with Dr. Weaver next Wednesday at 2:30 with the latest updates. Again, the data will drive our decisions as we manage our way through this, but until then and beyond, upon request from local officials, the Indiana Department of Homeland Security, including the State Fire Marshal, the Alcohol and Tobacco Commission, and the Indiana Department of Health, of course, will all be available to assess and support local needs. So that will be occurring even more so. Efforts will focus on counties that are showing as red and or orange on the state's positivity map, and may include additional support for medical resources, testing, contact tracing, and compliance with, of course, the ongoing focus on education. Since last winter, we have learned more, don't know everything, but we have learned more about the virus and what we must do to keep ourselves safe as possible. This is not the time to abandon what we've been doing. Just the opposite. We need to double down, or the numbers will double down on us. Like I said, the increases that we are experiencing in positivity and hospitalizations are not an Indiana phenomenon. We're not unique. All of our neighbors and many other states across the country are experiencing the same kinds of interest and increases. Just look at what's happening right now in Europe. An Indiana phenomenon is our ability, like we've done so many times in the past, to respond to unpredictable changes in this disease and take the actions necessary to balance all the needs of all Hoosiers, balance our lives and our livelihoods, our physical and our fiscal health. We all want to get to the finish line. We all want to return to how things were pre-COVID. We all want to see that checkered flag that I mentioned a while ago, and we will. But this race won't be completed until the data tells us so. And again, that will determine in part due to our own actions. And to get some supporting evidence of that, I'd like to turn it over now to Dr. Weaver for our latest health indicator update. Dr. Weaver.
Thank you, Governor. I'd like to start by discussing next steps for what we are doing in response to Dr. Box's positive test. As Dr. Box stated, all positive cases work with our state contact tracers to identify who is exposed, and in her case, the prior 48 hours. So anyone who is identified will complete the recommended 14 days of quarantine. Thankfully, Dr. Box and the rest of our team have been taking precautions to socially distance and, of course, wear our masks. However, out of an abundance of precaution, the governor, myself, and other members of the governor's office and the Indiana Department of Health will get tested this afternoon. Okay.
Thank you. need to unload your mic for your feedback.
Let's check and make sure it's, we'll give you a heads up if it's working.
Okay, so I think that I was accidentally muted, but hopefully you can hear me now. Okay, great. This is definitely real life. So thank you, Governor. I'd like to start by discussing next steps for what we are doing in response to Dr. Box's positive test. As Dr. Box stated, with all positive cases, Dr. Box worked with our state contact tracers to identify who was exposed to her in the prior 48 hours. Anyone identified will complete the recommended 14 days of quarantine. Thankfully, Dr. Box and the rest of our team have taken precautions to socially distance and wear our masks. However, out of an abundance of precaution, the governor, myself, members of the governor's office, and the Indiana Department of Health office will get tested this afternoon. Of course, I also wish Dr. Box and her family that they remain mildly symptomatic, they don't get any worse, and I hope that you guys all recover really quickly. Now, I'd like to reiterate that stage five does not mean life is back to pre-pandemic normalcy. This is our new normal. As you can see from the color-coded map, we can't afford to get complacent. We have a number of counties where COVID activity has increased. Last week, we had 39 counties in blue, 8 counties in orange, and 1 in red. And this week, we have 24 counties in blue, 21 in orange, and 1 Fountain in red. This shows increases in COVID activity in many areas of our state, and it's impacting not only our case counts and our positivity rates, but our hospital systems, which I will talk about in a moment. As you recall, when we first introduced the map, blue indicates minimal community spread. Yellow suggests moderate spread. Orange indicates medium to high community spread. And red indicates very high positivity and community spread. Today, we are providing very clear guidance and expectations on the actions that need to occur for each color. If your county is in blue, spread is minimal. Keep doing what you have been doing, but don't become complacent. If your county is in yellow, county health and other elected officials, health providers, school, and other key stakeholders should meet regularly to discuss conditions. You should evaluate the source of positive tests and undertake targeted testing, quarantine, and isolation. Your county should consider restrictions on the size of gatherings. Employers should restrict common areas and workplaces. School officials should review plans for face coverings and social distancing for all extracurricular activities and assemblies. If your county is in orange, the State Department of Health will convene the county health department, health providers, schools, elected officials, and other key stakeholders to discuss conditions and actions. The size of social gatherings should be restricted. Employers should restrict common areas and workplaces. Additional local monitoring of social distancing requirements at all events and venues should occur. The county should evaluate the source of positive tests and undertake targeted testing, quarantine, and isolation. County health officials and schools should place attendance restrictions on K-12 extracurricular activities and sports events. Participants should only meet if they're able to socially distance and wear face coverings. If your county is in red, the State Department of Health may take action to restrict counties. This could include restrictions on the size of social gatherings, restrictions on large events, business capacity restrictions, limits on visitation in congregate care, jails, hospitals, and closure of senior centers. Advising vulnerable populations to stay home, rescheduling elective hospital procedures, restricting attendance at K-12 extracurricular activities such as sports and music events to participants, coaches, and support staff only. The State Department of Health has been working with and will continue to work with our local public health officials, hospital leadership, and local elected officials to review and address each county's specific metrics and what they can do to impact those numbers. In addition to providing weekly webinars and sending in strike teams to long-term care and industrial settings, we contact every county that moves to orange or red each week to learn more about what's going on and identify any help that's needed. Dr. Box traveled to Vandenberg last week to meet with the health department, local officials, and hospital officials to discuss the rise in District 10 numbers. Dr. Box and I spent hours on the phone with officials all across Indiana, helping to identify challenges and resource needs as they battle increases in cases. What we keep hearing is that people don't think COVID is a thing, that people are gathering in large groups without masks, they're not social distancing, and essentially that they have pandemic fatigue. You can look at our numbers and see, it's clear, COVID is a thing. As the governor mentioned, our 7-day positivity rate has increased and stood at 5.3% as of October 7th, and the cumulative rate was 5.7%. Because we have a lag to allow all negative tests to be reported, those rates do not account for the large increase in cases we've seen over the last few days. So we could see them change again in the coming days. I also want to note that we are unfortunately experiencing a technical issue with our reporting system right now, and this is only impacting cases that are manually entered. We are working to resolve this as quickly as possible, but this could result in an influx of cases being reported on the dashboard all at once when the issue is resolved, and we will keep you posted on that. We're continuing to follow the guiding principles that Governor Holcomb delineated back in May and making adjustments when necessary. The first of those focus on the number of hospitalized COVID-19 patients. As of yesterday, a total of 1,357 Hoosiers were hospitalized with COVID or symptoms of COVID. That is the highest number we have seen since May 13th. And it underscores the importance of not letting our guard down. While our hospital systems are better equipped to handle COVID-19 than they were in the beginning of the pandemic, some are facing significant staffing challenges, especially with nurses. That's why we have partnered with the Bowen Center to send out another call for healthcare reservists to help fill those gaps. We are also talking constantly with hospital systems and monitoring data and EM resources daily to ensure that we can respond to the needs in real time. This is similar to what we did in the spring when we were doing surge planning. The second principle focuses on retaining our surge capacity for critical care beds and ventilators. Currently, just under 32% of ICU beds and about 78% of ventilators are available statewide. While the majority of ICU beds and ventilators are being used by people without COVID, we are seeing an increased need for the specialized care of people with COVID. Hospitals in districts 2, 6, and 10 are experiencing critical ICU bed shortages, along with personnel shortages. This is especially concerning because we have not begun to see the typical increase in ICU bed usage from influenza. I want to stress again that our hospital systems have done a fantastic job building their intensive care and ventilator capacity, but that should be our insurance plan. It's not something we want to have to use at full capacity. It is critical that our hospitals maintain their ability to care for Hoosiers with other life-threatening illnesses like cancer, heart disease, and strokes. So again, we are asking Hoosiers to follow the guidance that we have been providing for months so that we never exhaust our ability to care for our most critically ill Hoosiers. The third principle, as you recall, is the ability to test all Hoosiers who have symptoms of COVID-19. There are currently more than 260 locations around the state where you can get tested for COVID. The fourth principle is built on the ability to contact individuals who test positive for COVID-19 and expand contact tracing. Today, we have 955 contact tracers working as part of our centralized contact tracing operation, and another 371 in local health departments. Marin County plans to add another 300. We are seeing an increase in the number of close contacts per case, which suggests that people aren't maintaining those small social bubbles and practicing social distancing. The contact tracers also report that more people are refusing to complete the first contact tracing survey, which of course puts us all at greater risk for COVID and is a significant barrier to bringing our numbers back down. We have accomplished incredible things since the beginning of this pandemic, and we don't want to lose sight of that or lose our momentum. We continue to push out testing options, distributing Buy Next Now cards to congregate settings. And starting on Monday, we will also distribute BioNex cards to local health departments around the state who have established testing sites. The first priority will go to counties in red and orange. These cards provide test results within 15 minutes for people in their first 7 days of symptoms and will help accelerate the process of identification, isolation, and of course, contact tracing. In addition to these measures, we also built our statewide contact tracing system, and we increased our knowledge about the best way we can treat this disease medically. That work has enabled us to have our schools 97% open to at least some form of in-person instruction, and our economy and our businesses open more fully than other states. Unfortunately, many people have begun to treat this pandemic as if it is over, and our numbers reflect the impact of that loss of vigilance. We are not alone in seeing our numbers go up. Half of states are experiencing high numbers of cases, and those numbers are increasing. But we alone can change the course. Hoosiers, we are all over dealing with this, but this pandemic is not over, and it won't be over unless we all do our part. So we are asking you again to do what we know works and help us bring these numbers down. Wear your mask, socially distance, avoid large crowds, stay home if you're sick, and please get tested. If you are positive, answer the call when our contact tracers call and help us limit the spread of the disease, because these are the things that we now have to really compact to fight the disease. Please look at the choices you're making. Think of your grandmother, elderly neighbor, your coworker whose health is already compromised because of cancer or an immune system disorder. Think about how your own family will cope if you develop a severe case of COVID. This is about all of us. We can do this if we work together. Thank you.
Apologize for that audio interference. Obviously, we're all in different and separate locations. We turned and burned because of Dr. Fox's news today and adjusted our layout. Apologize for those audio problems that you've had to endure. We acted like MacGyver, I think, here, and really stitched things together within about a 5-minute period. So apologize for that. And Rachel, I know you're in a separate location. I'm hoping that you can hear me and you can do what you do and tee up the question. Hello again, Whitney.
Hello, Governor. Good afternoon again. Questions galore. How quickly can we expect results from your COVID-19 test and others, and what kind of tests will you be using? And I've got a follow-up after that.
Sure, and I'll kick this to Dr. Lindsay as well, but I'm assuming, I don't want to speak for the doctors, I learned that long ago, but I'm assuming I'll be leading a line of people to get tested right after we conclude this. I will quarantine myself until the time that I do get the results back. Those obviously that could change, so I don't want to give you a hard fast. I'll have it in my hand. But I would assume by midday tomorrow, obviously, that I've cleared my calendar, and I'll be going home and be in contact with people via the phone. Dr. Weaver, can I pitch it to you? And you want to talk about the test that we chose to do today?
actually all be doing two tests. We're going to be using our Indiana Department of Health lab, and they are ready for us. We're going to first start with a rapid test. If that is negative, we will do a follow-up PCR test that is run on one of our standard pieces of equipment, and we will have all of our test results back by hopefully by tomorrow morning, but at the latest midday tomorrow. So those are both PCR tests, but one are rapid. And as we tell all of our healthcare providers that, you know, it's recommended that if there's any concern at all, to follow up with the full PCR test.
Back to you, Whitney.
And just wanted to double check. So are you going to be quarantining regardless of your results? And then what would it take to reimpose restrictions when all of our metrics are going the wrong way? What about a mask mandate?
Yeah, we're obviously keeping the mask mandate. If I glossed over that, apologize. But the mask mandate will stay in place. It is what is working. It will work more the more people subscribe to reducing the odds, and the mask does that, of the spread. What it would take, again, just to underscore what I said earlier, it's not necessarily the size of an event that determines the spread. Obviously, if you're hosting an event and you're doing it responsibly, and we have countless examples of people who have adjusted the way that they do business or hold events or gather, and they're proving it can be done responsibly. That is why this ultimately comes down to our personal actions or inactions, and why we have really leaned into working with Elkhart, working with Vandenberg County, working with, you know, you pick it, because what this is proving, if you look at the map, I think Dr. Box or Dr. Weaver mentioned Fountain County. The virus is rolling around rural, urban, and suburban Indiana. And it always traces back to the surges, traces back to folks who just believe it won't happen to them, or the odds are it won't bring serious adverse harm to their health. And that's unfortunate, because it affects everyone differently. You just heard earlier today about an infant potentially being someone who passed it on to two adults, and of different, obviously, three generations. And we'll continue to look at what Dr. Weaver just outlined, every indicator, and continue to lean into helping local communities better trace, better enforce those things which will lead to bringing the numbers down. Afternoon, Rob.
Afternoon, Governor. Dr. Box, I echo the sentiments and wish you and your family a speedy recovery. I had two questions. Dr. Weaver, as the number of cases goes up, does the state have enough contact tracing workers to keep up with the increased demand?
So yes, we do believe that we have a good number of contact tracers at this time, but it's something that we're continuing to monitor. And if we do need more contact tracers, then absolutely that is something that we will do. It really is the combination of the state contact tracers and also what is done at the local level. But none of it works if people don't answer the phone call when we call them when they're positive and participate in the contact tracing process. And then on the other end, it also doesn't work if people don't answer the call if potentially they were somewhere
someone who is identified as being exposed. And then the most important thing is that when you are identified as a close contact or as a positive case, that you properly complete your full 10 days of isolation if you're positive, and your full 14 days if you're considered to be a close contact.
Good afternoon, Sherry.
Good afternoon, Governor. Thank you for returning to this comment. I think there are a lot of people out there who are not understanding why we are still in stage five. They think there is a disconnect between the numbers that we're seeing, the direction things are going, and not taking more direct action to try to turn back the tide, especially with flu season approaching. So I'm hoping you can address those voices, which I assure you are in my inbox, and explain a little bit more your decision to keep us in stage five.
I think this is very important that this is not lost on any of the 6.7 million Hoosiers out there. And that is, every one of these cases is a extremely localized occurrence, every single one of them. And for us to continue to balance our lives and our livelihoods, we don't get to say, and we don't want to go back to a shutdown. We don't get to say, we'll shut everything down to zero, pull our kids out of school, and figure out a way later to care for all those that are in need. We are proving, there is proof out there that folks are operating responsibly in stage five. We need to do more of that, not less of that. That gets us through this. And all the issues, when we ratchet it down and start to shut down, in the very beginning when we had a hunker down, that was for the very reason to get our footing. We were starting almost at a standstill, facing a global pandemic of likes the world has not seen in a century. We had to beef up our supply chains, our PPE. Everyone had to come together to make sure that we were operating as one, including our hospitals, including our nonprofit sector, our private sector, and government, all three levels. And we did that, and we saw promise, and we saw progress. And the pain that will come from assuming that if we just restrict down or shut down, and it'll have no adverse impacts, it's our behavior, it is our actions that need to be addressed, and they have to be addressed together. It doesn't, the shutting down approach is missing the point. It is trying to say, and by the way, again, Sherry, I would point you to some other states who have capacity limits of 10 that are dealing with this as well, while other issues are mounting. And so when I'm talking to my gubernatorial cohorts around the country, we're all seeing a rise, especially in the Midwest right now. And we all can trace it back to not a stage, but behavior and actions and folks who are cavalier. And that can happen in a setting of 2 or 20 or 200 or 2,000. We can responsibly go to a major league sporting event if it's pulled off safely, and they have been. So that's what I would offer. Good afternoon, Jessica.
Good afternoon, Governor. I was wondering if you could comment on political candidates like Donald Rainwater, who are holding in-person campaign events in Indiana. Is that something you would advise that they stop doing at this time?
Jessica, I'm really hesitant to use this channel for political purposes. I will take the word political out of it and address it more generically. And absolutely, people ought to be able to have events, weddings, where we see through contact tracing, where a lack of adhering to these best practices can lead to some bad results that others regret later. And so it would be inconsistent for me to say, don't hold events. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying the opposite. I'm saying you can do this and you can do it responsibly. We can continue to operate our businesses and do them responsibly. It's what Dr. Weaver said. We work way too hard at the outset to just think this is behind us. If anything, this COVID-19 is proving that it is enduring. And we need to express just as much endurance. Afternoon, Tracy.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Clear.
Great. Governor, you and Dr. Box have really pleaded with Hoosiers not to take the state's reopening as an invitation to let their guards down. But county health officials are increasingly expressing concern over people's decreased willingness to wear masks or practice physical distancing. I'm wondering what guidance state officials have for those concerned local health departments, and if you'll reinstate tougher rules in hotspots around the state to help out as well.
Really good point. That's in my kind of opening remarks as I was rambling around, I know. And repeating myself, that was the point about the Department of Homeland Security and our state fire marshal and ATC, excise police. We are looking to provide support, whether that's, like Dr. Weaver said, more tracing that really gives us an eye into the ground level, what's happening on the ground, or boots on the ground to help locals, not just in tracing, but to educate. Again, the local communities are being stressed because of just what you said, Tracy. People are just acting like this won't affect them, or it won't fatally affect them, or they'll get through it. It's just like in our long-term care centers. The most vulnerable among us, it does not start inside our long-term care centers. It starts outside in the community. Those rates have a lot to do with community spread. That's the origin. And so just like everything else we do around here, we have to look at the root causes. And assuming that some blanket response will solve it, that's being proven inaccurate. And so, yes, we will look to, and when Dr. Weaver was going over the orange and the red, she was very explicit, very blunt about, you know, if we need to return to that on a very surgical response to surges that occur, we may do that. I'll be back Wednesday, if not before, if we need to do it before next Wednesday. But having said that, hopefully people will see that the trends, we can bend it down just like we've bent it up. And I'm hopeful that this message will get through. Afternoon, Max. Stephanie.
Okay, did that work? Can you hear me? Okay, good. Can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you now, Stephanie. Sorry about that.
Oh, no, you're okay. Well, first of all, I just wanted to say, Dr. Box, you know, all of us at WRTV, we're hoping for a speedy recovery for you and your family and all of the Hoosiers battling this virus right now. For you, Governor, what do you make of Chicago adding Indiana to its traveler quarantine list? And is this an indication of how our state is doing right now with the rising cases? How should people be feeling right now?
People should be feeling like the trend is moving in the wrong direction. And what do I need to do to bend that trend down? And as this is not ideal to be masked up, my glasses fog, as you can very well see. But these are measures, physically distancing, these are measures that will reduce and bring down our odds. And I think the mayor of Chicago, there are different lists to look at. We're one of, I don't know, 30 states on that list, 20, 30 states. And I think the mayor of Chicago has the best interests of the health and safety of her citizens. And is probably pleading with, I've not spoken with her directly, but is probably pleading with her citizens, folks who are inside the city, to practice good hygiene, all these best practices. And I think she has the best interest of her city and at heart and of mind, and so do I for our state. And the quicker we both, because this is happening all over the Midwest, the quicker we both and our other neighbors can bring down these numbers, obviously the more lives and livelihoods we will save. Afternoon, Angelica.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me? You can certainly correct me if I'm wrong. It seems that we've seen these spikes in cases after some of these holiday weekends, Memorial Day, 4th of July, Labor Day, and we're heading into now Halloween, which is a weekend that a lot of people go out and celebrate. You know, are you concerned about seeing even more spikes coming? Halloween weekend, and what is your advice to people that may want to go out and celebrate?
I'm concerned every minute of the day about not just holidays, but about the throwing caution to the wind. And as I said earlier, and whenever we increase those odds by not subscribing to the science and knowing what works, I get even more concerned. I will say that we will be back, obviously, again next Wednesday, and that will be before Halloween. Obviously, local communities, again, can be more stringent than the state in terms of gathering. We'll support those measures and approaches. And then we may have more to say, too, as we see where we are across the whole state. county by county. But again, with there's what I do want to just stress, Angelica, is there's this notion of a one size fits all hasn't worked in very many locations, and we'll continue to work with local communities with all of our state resources, which will include events like holidays.